Hi.
Hi, welcome to Heliotropes. My name's Julia.
My name's Kojo. And we've got a good show for y'all today. We're going to start with a brief update, real quick. Unemployment at 26 million now, as of last week. That's 17% of the American eligible labor force. That's huge. This in the midst of impending economic recession. And Brian Kemp, Georgia Governor Brian Kemp, opening the state back up for businesses. Unpreparedly, you want to say something about that?
He has deemed specific businesses to be essential now, including hair salons, tattoo parlors, gyms. I think there's some dining in. There's also nail salons that are open. So they opened on Friday, right, and more will be opening on Monday.
That's that, right? Obviously, it's receiving, the decision has received a lot of criticism as far as Georgia is concerned, as far as racial issues and class issues being concerned. Georgia has the highest number as far as American cities, proportionally, of African-American residents, which creates this issue. You know, like, if African-Americans are already at a higher predisposition to severe outcome from coronavirus, and the city has more African-American residents than any other American city by percentage, then, if you can't follow that, you know, line of logic, or where I'm going with that, it's a conspiracy, you know, and I'm not saying that in a sarcastic way, but it falls in line with the grand conspiracy of American history, which is to undermine the physical integrity, mental, emotional integrity of people of color, specifically African-American people, as one of the main groups in this country. It falls very much in line with that, so that's something to keep in mind.
Yeah, and another piece of that too is he reopened businesses against advice from experts in terms of medical experts and the CDC, because coronavirus cases in Georgia are still steadily increasing by the day. And the other financial economic impact that this can have is that because these places of business can be open, they may not be eligible to receive financial assistance anymore. Same goes for the employees. If they're able to return to work because the business has been opened, then they may not be eligible for unemployment, which then forces some people into making a choice that can put their life at risk, which isn't really a choice at all.
Right. Just as well, there is new information in the Tara Reade sexual assault case. If you don't know the story, Tara Reade came forward. She was a former staffer on the Biden campaign, and in 1993 she was sexually assaulted by Joe Biden. She told some people then. She tried to report it. She sent a report to the office at the time. It didn't go anywhere. She told her mother and her brother and another friend, but she didn't tell many people. And needless to say, between 1993 and, you know, this year, 2020, the story didn't really go anywhere for reasons that we discussed actually three podcasts back. It was our second podcast, so look that up. We'll link it in the description. But it didn't go anywhere. She reported it until this year. It didn't go anywhere. And she received a lot of backlash. The story received a lot of backlash, a lot of discreditation. Very unaligned with everything that the Me Too movement was supposed to represent. And in short, it's a highly credible story that's been swept under the rug because of what damage it could do to Joe Biden's career and the possibility of getting Trump out of the White House, because that's the only thing that matters now, you know, in life. It's the only thing that matters. I say that, yeah, sarcastically. But this recent news, a lot of people were saying, oh, you know, this is uncredible. People who were sweeping it under the rug, Alyssa Milano and such. Ryan Grimm, he's the reporter who first broke the case, and he just discovered that Tara Reade's mother made a call from San Obispo, California, back in the day, in 1993, after Tara Reade had told her this, made a call to the Larry King live show and asked about what to do if, like a staffer said her daughter was a former staffer for a high-profile senator, politician, and she asked for advice. Just the existence of that call, and there's audio for it, right? It was recorded. Just the existence of that call is a major support to the story, to her story, right? Because one of, again, the things that when survivors come forward and they try to share their stories, people who discredit them tend to say things like, how do I know this is real? If you didn't tell anybody, then, what reason is there to believe you? Mm-hmm. So obviously the OGs, the real ones out there, were believing her before this evidence came to light. But the point is, if that is someone's, actual reason or, excuse for not believing her, they don't have that excuse anymore, because this is a huge piece of evidence that supports her claim of sexual assault, specifically by Joe Biden.
And it's at least indicative that there should be ongoing investigations into her allegations.
Right. With that being said, we're going to move on to the topic of today's show, which is domestic violence and... it's mostly going to be around domestic violence and how that affects, how that's been exacerbated by the current healthcare and economic conditions in the country.
Yeah, so in terms of a content warning, we're going to be discussing statistics and situations, but not specific incidents of domestic violence or interpersonal violence. There are various kind of terms. And we're going to be talking about them in different countries across the globe. So, before we kind of like jump into some of those things, we do want to clarify that our reporting about domestic violence isn't indicative of how we feel about certain countries or certain populations. So, as we know, oppressive structures exist everywhere in the world, and they manifest differently. And we take issues with a lot of those structures, and many of those structures manifest in violence of some sort against various populations. So that feels important for us to mention, because we're going to be talking about some countries that we believe... Okay. It just feels important to mention, and you'll understand when we get there.
Hopefully. If you don't understand, then don't worry about it.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So, according to the World Health Organization, 1 in 3 women will experience some sort of physical or sexual violence in their lifetime, which makes violence against women one of the most widespread and least discussed human rights violations globally, and also one of the most endorsed, because violence against women is used as a tool of war. In terms of abuse and how we're working off defining abuse, so it has to do with power and control. So abuse in a relationship, or really in any kind of context, is an attempt to gain power and control. And the abuser in that situation feels that their feelings are the priority in that relationship, that they should get what they want, that they should feel how they want to feel, even when that comes at the expense of somebody else. And that's often, obviously, what happens in terms of abusive relationships. So abuse is a learned behavior, whether it's from family relationships or other previous relationships, or... societal messages. It is a learned behavior, and it is also 100% a choice that individuals make to abuse other individuals or groups of people or hold abusive ideologies. Abuse can take the can take many forms. So if you look up the power and control wheel, you'll see this. So there's a lot of different forms, and so that you could, an abuser could use coercion and threats in terms of like anything in somebody's life. They can use intimidation. That could include looking at somebody in a way with the intent of scaring them, right? And that doesn't mean necessarily like when you're walking down a street and like you see somebody and you're trying to scare them, but what that indicates, if it's in a relationship, is like a cycle of violence and a cycle of control, and like if one look can kind of control somebody and make them completely shift their behavior, right? That's intimidation, and pretty intense intimidation at that. Isolating somebody from all of their support networks and family and friends, minimizing, denying, and blaming or gaslighting. Using children against somebody, so threatening to take control of the children or encouraging the children to also like attack the individual, engaging in toxic masculinity or using male privilege. So perhaps I should have mentioned at the beginning, one of the reasons that we're focusing, or most of the research that I'm going to share, is around women as victims and survivors of domestic violence, because they encounter domestic violence at such greater rates than men do. However, men can also be victims and survivors of domestic violence. So it's not to take away from that. It's just to elevate one aspect of interpersonal violence. Economic abuse is another form, and then physical and sexual abuse. And so physical and sexual abuse is usually the kind of like the last form of abuse. And then all of those other things I just mentioned, right, like kind of perpetuate the abuse, and then validate the physical and sexual violence, and the physical and sexual violence can then validate those other forms of abuse as well. If somebody you know has been physically or sexually abused, they have likely been psychologically abused, emotionally abused, financially abused, threatened, intimidated, etc. In terms of the cycle of abuse, it typically happens in 4 stages. So the first stage is that tensions start to build, and then you might feel like you're walking around on eggshells, and then the incident happens. So whatever that incident is, if it's physical abuse, that's when that happens. And that, you know, can really vary in terms of how long it lasts and how intense it is. The third stage is some sort of reconciliation. So that could be like an apology, the abuser feeling guilty and expressing that, saying that they won't do that again and they didn't mean to and they care about that individual. And then the fourth stage is a calmness. So it's when things in the relationship feel okay again. And what happens is that over a period of time, right, abuse escalates and it gets worse and worse and can increase in intensity to the point where the walking on eggshells to the incident, that time significantly decreases, and then the time between incidents significantly decreases to the point where there really may not be a calm time or really or any reconciliation at all. It might always feel like walking around on eggshells until the incident happens, and then back on eggshells, and then the incident happens again. A lot of people wonder, well, let me back up in terms of the cycle of abuse. So one of the concerns right now in terms of coronavirus is because so many people are like in their spaces together, like their family spaces together, one of the concerns is that the abuse could escalate much more quickly than it would as if everybody was able to kind of go about their daily lives. So whereas somebody could have been experiencing emotional abuse on a regular basis, they could also now be experiencing emotional and physical abuse because of the additional stressors. A lot of people wonder why individuals stay in abusive relationships, and there are a number of reasons for that, and relationships are unique and individuals are unique, but there are some common factors in terms of reasons that people stay in those relationships. There's often a lot of fear, a fear of what will happen if they leave. We know that women are at the greatest risk, at least in the United States, of being killed by their partner when they make the decision to leave and attempt to leave. There could also be, if you are leaving a relationship in which there are children, you also may be foregoing your children if you decide to leave. There's a fear of, you know, like the unknown and what could happen outside of that relationship because you may have grown accustomed to, or people may have grown accustomed to the abusive relationship and believe that that's how all relationships are and that their relationship is simply normal. There could be financial dependence, physical dependence, depending on identities, embarrassment and shame around what's going on in the relationship. We know that some abusers have public personas that are very charming and loving, and a lot of folks believe in them, or they might be police officers. We know that a lot of police officers are perpetrators of domestic violence. And so the idea of then having to come forward and leave a relationship and explain that to people can cause a lot of embarrassment and shame. Love. I mean, love is always a reason that people stay in relationships. And just because the relationship is abusive doesn't mean that that is any different, that people believe they love somebody or really do. There are also cultural and religious reasons that people may not feel like they can leave the relationship. And immigration status, depending again on identities. So in terms of what we know about what exacerbates domestic violence, we know that financial instability exacerbates domestic violence, and that times when families are together more often, rates of domestic violence increase. So if we think about what's happening now, Kojo talked about the unemployment numbers. And even though that's like different globally because different governmental structures have provided different kinds of support, folks, many people across the world are out of jobs. And that is increasing tensions in the home, not only because there's a loss of income, but also because people are home all the time together. And we don't know what kind of spaces they're in, right? They might be in like really cramped spaces. And one of the dangers around that is, right, like if you're not able to kind of like go out and leave, if tensions are constantly building and constantly building, you're always in the same space, there's no way to escape, especially for countries that have pretty strict lockdowns. In the United States, a lot of folks are under shelter in place orders, and a lot of other countries across the world, you can be arrested by the police for leaving your home unless you're going to a pharmacy or a grocery store to get medical help. So the risks of leaving your home are much greater in some countries. Additionally, there is a lack of that informal support now in terms of like going to school or seeing coworkers or seeing family or friends, because people aren't allowed to leave their homes. Some people are concerned to go seek medical services at hospitals from the abuse they've experienced because they don't want to contract coronavirus. Some people don't feel comfortable seeking refuge with like parents or other friends because of the threat of coronavirus. And so people are really stuck in these situations without anywhere else to go and with additional stressors that are causing perpetrators to engage in abuse more often. Not in the way that that gives them an excuse, but in a way that that is increasing tensions and stressors without any way to relieve those stressors that they've learned. So I'm going to share some information from some different countries across the world. It is incredibly important that you remember that a lot of domestic violence incidents are not reported. So keep that in mind when you hear some of the statistics. So in China, in an area close to Wuhan, where the belief is that coronavirus began, the calls to report domestic violence to the local police tripled in February compared to the previous year. So, you know, triple the amount of calls into the hotline. In France, there was a 30% increase in domestic violence reports following lockdown on March 17th. After initial decreased calls in the first week. And that's important to remember, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. In Spain, during the first 2 weeks of lockdown, one of their hotlines received 18% more calls, and their email is up 268% to report incidents of domestic violence or to get some kind of support or some kind of resources. And their new WhatsApp service that this organization developed received 168 inquiries in its first 9 days. In Singapore, there are 30% more hotline calls. In Italy, there's a 75% increase in calls during March compared to March of 2018. And 28% of those callers this March were new callers. More than 2,800 women contacted one of their centers. And this is just in one organization, right? So we don't have necessarily national statistics for all of these countries. And some of the other statistics in Italy, so many countries across the world use the term femicide, which means the killing of a woman because she is a woman. The United States does not use that language. But in Italy in 2019, 82% of the violence committed against women took place in their home, right? So that's the other thing that we know about violence against women. It is most often committed by somebody that the woman knows, especially when we're talking about male-identified perpetrators. And in March 2019, the report of violence against women, or every 15 minutes, there was a report of violence against women. Right, so these numbers are staggering, and they are on the rise because of the current situations that we're experiencing with the health pandemic and the economic crisis. In Palestine, so far this year, there have been 11 deaths of women, and 6 of them happened during the lockdown alone. And to kind of like put that in context to women who are living under the Israeli occupation, Palestinian women, make up 50% of the domestic violence cases, despite being only 20% of the population. And one of the reasons that Palestinian women living under Israeli occupation are in a unique position in terms of experiencing domestic violence and also state violence, is that how you would refer to it? War, terror. And so in terms of like living under the Israeli occupation, right, and then having to manage being oppressed as Palestinian and then oppressed as women by Israelis and then also in their own homes or by their own communities, they're experiencing just like an increased amount of violence, and it's difficult to get any of those cases push through any of the legal systems as well. There's only a 20% success rate in murder cases for Palestinian women under Israeli occupation. There are a couple of organizations in Palestine, and probably more than a couple, just a couple that were in the news, who are doing incredible work. One of them received 30% more calls in the past few weeks. And one of the hotlines received 925 calls between March 22nd and April 15th. And these are only the women who are calling and reporting, or the neighbors who are calling and reporting to help other folks. All right, one of the other complicating factors that has been reported in Palestine from at least one of the NGOs is that women who want to leave their relationships and go into a shelter need to be, they're being screened for coronavirus symptoms. And if they screen positive, then they need to self-isolate somewhere for 14 days, which typically means that they would need to pay for a hotel for 14 days, which is obviously problematic for many women because that's not something that they can afford to do. They did, however, report on a positive note. They've had a lot of friends who have been able to, people who work for the NGO have a lot of friends who have donated money so that women can have a safe place to stay, because the NGO also doesn't have enough resources for that. So both of the organizations, the two feminist organizations that I've been referencing, Tala and Asiwar, are both fighting for Palestinian liberation as well, which we are also very much on board for. And one of their kind of statements around that is that patriarchal and colonial violence go together. You cannot have one without the other. And in order to really create a free Palestine, that involves the liberation of all marginalized groups, including women. And so right now, Palestinian women under Israeli occupation, like when we think about solutions and in Palestine, you can't ask inherently violent structures, right, to just kind of be less violent or to provide solutions on their own. And that is something that we will see, I think, like, and really in many of the governments that we're talking about.
Yeah. And that's one of the things that Julie and I were talking about yesterday was the universality of anti-woman, anti-femme violence amongst cultures around the world. And it is worth noting that in the sense that it's not intrinsic to the human condition to demean women, and I think there's an argument to be made that it's quite the opposite, that the reason, a major reason that we see this universality having arisen is because of colonial tendencies, that the proliferation of the Western colonial dynamic, and, you know, I'm going to go out on a limb and say it, the Arabic colonial dynamic as well. Between the two of those, there's a lot of responsibility for those two cultures, cultural ancestors to bear.
Right, so everything that Kojo just mentioned is going to come into play with the United States and the countries in Latin America as well, which we'll get to in a moment. So in terms of sharing information about the United States, in the U.S., there's an act of domestic violence every 15 seconds, with 4 women losing their lives on a daily basis due to domestic violence. And according to one source, since the shelter-in-place orders in various cities and states across the country have started, there has been a surge of around 35% increase in domestic violence calls to, I believe, police stations. And as I mentioned before, there's no standardized definition of femicide in the United States, which is the killing of women or women and girls due to their sex or gender identity. But according to the Violence Policy Center, about almost 2,000 women were murdered in 2017 in instances that seemed to be femicide or domestic violence related. And 2017 is the last year that the Violence Policy Center has full and analyzed statistics from. And they get their statistics from the FBI and then filter them for incidents in which there is one male-identified perpetrator and a female-identified victim. And so of those 2,000 women who were murdered, 92% of the women were murdered by a man who they knew and with a gun, and 62% of those 2,000 women murdered were murdered by a partner or an ex-partner.
And just to, so there's a couple of things. On the one hand, as far as the statistic that Julia just mentioned, it's solid evidence that at least locally in the United States, domestically, the incidence of domestic violence, intimate violence is, those statistics suggest that domestic violence, contrary to popular belief, is more likely to be perpetrated by someone who knows the victim, right? Someone who knows the victim closely. You know, they said partners, former partners, ex-partners, which, again, runs contrary to the popular notion that if you're to experience some sort of level of intimate violence, it's going to be from a stranger, right? Like Julia said in one of the previous takes, you know, a stranger in a dark alley, right? And that's it's ingrained into the popular imagination, in the media, and other things we'll get to later. But my point here is that it's important to keep in mind that that narrative is incorrect as far as it bears out in the statistics, because, again, you're more likely to experience this kind of violence from someone who you do know, right, than a stranger. And that you can scale that out, right, to the world at large, mm-hmm. right?
Or you might be more likely to perpetrate violence against somebody you know than you would be to a stranger.
Right, right. Oh, that's a really important one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So check on your friends. Ask your friends. Talk to your friends about their behaviors in terms of behaviors toward other people and anything that they may have experienced themselves.
Especially men, right? Because it's easy to, you know, tell women to check on their friends, their male friends, but at the end of the day, the group, yeah, and this is speaking just, you know, from the standpoint of understanding how these dynamics work as a man, male, complicity, right? If I'm complicit in, through silence or through like tacit endorsement or whatever, in condoning the abuse of my male friends, that's probably going to go, if not further, then it's going to hit differently than if their female friends or woman-identified friends were also endorsing the same behavior, right? So, and vice versa, if I condone that behavior, if I condemn that behavior, it's going to hit differently than if... if a woman condemns that same behavior. And a lot of that has to do with the way society perceives, I mean, certain things, but like, you know, ultimately it does come down to the fact that this is a patriarchal society. So, you know, a woman can come up and say, hey, that thing's terrible. It's right, like the racism thing. I can go up to a white person and be like, hey, that shit's racist. You shouldn't do it. And they're going to receive that differently than like, if Julia goes up to that same white person and is like, hey, that shit's racist, you know, you shouldn't do it. And you're like, you know, yeah. And that, I don't know exactly why that is, but it's worth keeping in mind. If you're a man, make sure, right, you have that much more of a responsibility to make sure that your friends are not being abusers.
Yeah. Power and in-group relatedness, I think, are some of the reasons that that happens. Yeah. And also, domestic violence, sexual assault, violence against women is not a woman's issue. It's a man's issue as perpetrators of the violence. Abuse is a perpetrator issue. It's not a victim or survivor issue.
Right. That, again, translates to race, right? Like, you don't blame black people for racism because white people created it, right? So, I mean, that's an easy parallel. Like, if you don't get it, if you don't get why it's important to, right, why feminism's important, why it's important to hold abusers accountable and not to victim blame, that's a really easy parallel that a lot of people understand on across a lot of spectrums.
Mm-hmm. And just as a slight tangent, not because it's off topic, but because it's not in the place that it's supposed to be right now, the victim blaming piece, right, like thinking about domestic violence and governmental responsibility and organizational responsibility and in general, like the world's response to domestic violence is often to create and fund shelters and help women try and find a way out and help provide resources for women, which is really important work, and some organizations are doing incredible work around that. And also, it doesn't solve the problem. Like, it's not actual prevention work, right? And so, like, these government groups and other NGOs doing that are also following along the line with, like, not necessarily victim blaming, but like a lack of prevention and like a lack of understanding about what actually happens and a lack of willingness to hold the perpetrators accountable in any sort of meaningful way to create any sort of like significant cultural change. Like, it's a band-aid solution that is incredibly difficult to sustain and to be, like, helpful for a lot of psychological reasons that we don't need to go into right now. But, yeah. You said that there were two things in terms of the statistics we can get back on. Back in line now.
The next thing is, and this is also, you know, a bit tangential, but it is important for contextualizing. As Julie and I were talking about pretty recently, when you're understanding how certain marginalized groups have been oppressed, for the most part, whether it's conscious or unconscious, there is a historical association with it. There's a historical anchor, right? So if you're talking about African-Americans and how, like, African-Americans today are being oppressed, whether you agree with it or not, people go back to slavery. They say, oh, okay, yes. Well, like, they either say, ah, slavery, I understand. African-Americans were oppressed, and that still happens to this day. Or they say, oh, okay, well, slavery was 400 years ago, who cares? But regardless, they're able to go back to a point of, like, in time where that oppression was politically, socially sanctioned and had consequences. Same thing with anti-Semitism. People can go back to a time and a place and either, you know, whether they agree with it or not, for the most part, save Holocaust deniers, agree that, you know, at some point there was the social reality, the political reality, the reality of Jewish people in Germany in the mid 20th century was something that could have repercussions into this day, something that made it clear that the deck was stacked against Jewish people. For women, that's not so obvious, and I do think that in large part, going back to what we were saying about the impact of colonialism, it's because, regardless of where you, I guess ultimately it's because the patriarchal nature of society was already ingrained into the colonial, right, into the pre-colonial society that, which was introduced to the different settler colonial and, you know, colonial societies afterwards, from the 15th century onward. And that is to say that women's issues didn't seem as prominent because women were already being oppressed by the European society long before European society expanded out to oppress other cultures. So it's a lot more subtle. But some examples, right? And these come from the medieval Europe, European days. Ideas of female vassalage, woman vassalage, that is that the woman was the property of her husband, right? And to be treated as such, the children included. Or this, and I forget what it's called, but the rule of
First night,
which was a rule applied, I don't know in exactly what kingdoms, but it's a feudal law, which permitted kings the right to spend the first night of the marriage of any woman in the kingdom.
Rape.
Right, yeah, yeah. The kings were, it legally permitted kings to rape women on their wedding nights, or, you know, the first nights of their...
The women's marriage. Wedding nights, not the king's wedding nights.
Right.
So,
right.
like many women. Right. You can check out Braveheart. It's in there.
It's in Braveheart. And it has a name. Might link it in the description. But, you know, that is... The point is, these are concrete examples, again, harkening back to even before the former two examples, of times when... socially, politically, you know, legally, women were not only seen as, women were seen as property, and women were seen as property to be used, you know, for childbearing, for fornication, for different things, right? And that has direct parallels to today, where women might not be seen explicitly as property in the eyes of society as a whole, but are still clearly seen in a way as to suggest that their services are better employed in wage-free labor, and right, like, you know, you look at the political social right, the far right, you know, it's the ideas actually aren't that much further developed from where they were in Europe several hundred years ago.
So yeah, thanks for providing some of that historical context, because as we were talking about it, I couldn't for the life of me wrap my head around the idea that people wouldn't understand the historical context of that, which now I realize like is definitely my bad, because those things do need to be explained, because we all have, I mean, like, one, access to different resources and understandings and educations, and two, very different perspectives on things for various reasons, including, you know, like identities and maybe how we were raised and those things. So I appreciate you sharing more about that historical context, and it's definitely not something I could have done in a pleasant manner.
Hey, teamwork.
Yeah. Hey. So we're going to shift. Well, actually, I do want to share a couple things in terms of how coronavirus is impacting domestic violence in the United States, in addition to increased calls and the need for increased services for RAIN, which is a sexual, the Hotline for Sexual Assault Prevention and Survivors, and the National Hotline for Domestic Violence. And that is, you know, similar to what we talked about with some of the shelters in Palestine. Like, shelters just have a varying amount of resources. So some of them are at max capacity and can't accept any more individuals. And some shelters are having, like, some women and children are staying in shelters much longer than they normally would because they can't get jobs, so they can't then kind of sustain their daily life, right, because of how bad the economy is right now, and because the United States government is not set up in a capacity to support people who are out of work. In addition, coronavirus is being used as a threat by abusers. So I didn't write down the statistic, but I believe, and maybe it was the national hotline that receives around 2,000 calls a day or a week. I don't remember what it was, but about 50% of the people who called in mentioned that their partner or the person that they were living with was threatening them with coronavirus, whether that was like to kick them out on the street so then they wouldn't be safe. And like, imagine being in a place like New York City or New Jersey, or being on, like, living in the Navajo Nation and having that be a threat, right? Where it is a very real possibility that you could contract coronavirus. And some people are being kicked out of their homes or being abused or whatever it might be because their partner believes that they have coronavirus or infected them with coronavirus. So it's just, it's a unique position that I don't think, I mean, none of us thought we were ever going to be in. And then shelters and other places that provide resources, I mean, they just didn't know and they don't have enough resources, and that's not really on them. I want to shift in a little bit to talking about our last section of the world that we're going to talk about today. And we're going to talk a little bit about Colombia and Venezuela and Mexico. Excuse me. In Colombia, about 2 women are killed every day, according to the Femicide Observatory there, which is an organization in Colombia. And in the first weeks of lockdown in Bogota, they reported that all crimes were down except for one, and that crime is domestic violence. So all of their crimes were down, homicides, theft, whatever it was, except for domestic violence, that was on the rise. And there was a 225% increase in calls to the police hotline to report violence against women. 225% increase. So the president ordered local governments to provide support, but one study showed that almost 600 police stations didn't have the appropriate infrastructure to manage phone calls, or like digital infrastructure where they could take in that information. Because one of the things that's going on with lockdowns is that people who are being abused, the women who are being abused, often can't make phone calls because they're in the same space as the abuser. Right. And so unless they're in some like grand, large mansion home, there's not a lot of privacy. So a lot of organizations and hotlines are having to implement other digital ways of being in touch, whether it's like WhatsApp groups or online chat or those kinds of things. And not all organizations have that infrastructure. It is disturbing, though, that that many police stations would not have some sort of infrastructure in place to provide that kind of support. So a lot of that task is falling onto organizations who are unfamiliar with the areas that they are supposed to be, you know, kind of taking care of. And in terms of Venezuela, there's some information there about the migrant communities. And one specific community that's on the border between Venezuela and Colombia. And so similarly to how we talked about Palestinian women, especially those living under Israeli occupation, migrant women are in unique dangers, right? They're already vulnerable populations. And so they're at increased risk for violence in this current situation. So they implemented a WhatsApp hotline, which received like a huge rise in calls once shelter in place and lockdown orders were set. And then what they found out is that when they were trying to direct them to migrant shelters, many of those shelters had closed down. Either they weren't deemed like essential businesses or they couldn't stay open for whatever reason, like health concerns. So that was, you know, like women then didn't have a choice. They didn't have anywhere else to go. So they're being locked down in their home with their abusers. And then in Mexico, Mexican advocates for domestic violence or for women and their safety, talk about domestic violence being a chronic problem in Mexico with a long history that varies in intensity. But they mentioned numbers that around 10 women are killed daily in Mexico by men, which, I mean, it's heartbreaking. And, you know, the assumption in the reports are that the domestic violence is increasing due to the lockdown. So as of April 10th, the national hotline in Mexico experienced a 60% increase in calls. And there's some kind of like strong beliefs there that they think the state has really neglected gender-based violence, which, I mean, is definitely true in the U.S. and is definitely true in most of the countries across the world too. So they're certainly not alone in that. I do want to share a couple really cool things that, are happening in Mexico that, we found out about. So on March 8th, to celebrate International Women's Day, 13 cities in Mexico held marches that turned out unprecedented numbers of women and protesters. And then on March 9th, a couple organizations created a women's strike, which is really cool. And about 57% of women in the workforce, which is about 6.6 million women, did not leave their homes for work. And one of the organizers was talking about how like metro cars were empty, streets were empty, that it was something that they had never really seen before in their lifetime, which is an incredibly powerful statement. Similarly, in Palestine, there were protests, I think like around those same dates as well, which just feels important to mention because shortly after that is when all the lockdowns were happening, right? So like, when people and women felt maybe like momentum was being gained and they made these really powerful statements, which they did, then domestic violence went on the rise again for reasons like just so far outside of their control. One of the organizations in Mexico, Brujas del Mar, has funneled all of their resources into responding to the rise in violence against women in terms of supporting women. So they're one of the organizations that helped to organize the Women's March and then the Women's Strike on the 9th of March. And they're bolstering their digital work and they're creating new things to do. One of the things that they're able to do is do like a virtual accompaniment for women that have to go to work and are walking through streets by themselves and when they may feel unsafe, which I thought is really cool. And then another organization that was focused around providing anti-machismo counseling and work and programming can no longer provide in-person counseling. So they have created a hotline that men can use to kind of like alleviate their tension so that they will not engage in violence against their partner. And they are receiving calls daily, and some of the calls are really intense that they talked about, and they're ranging from, you know, like a desire to commit like immediate violence and intense is the only way I can really think about it, in a really intense way. That's just a great service and something that should be happening on a much greater scale.
Right. And it goes really directly to what Julia was saying earlier about on the victim-blaming front, you know, about how there's these host of services that are directed at taking care of things post-abuse, but not enough directed at on the prevention side of things. And this is a really great example of work that is being done on the prevention side of things.
Yeah.
It's a call center, you know, like we can set stuff like that up here. I guess we'll get to that later.
Yeah. And France has one of those hotlines as well, which is, I think, just, you know, important to give props where props are due.
Continuing on, one of the things that I'd like to discuss on this issue in relation to everything that's been discussed already, everything, all of the information that Julia has delivered very insightfully, is the idea of culture, right? And the cultural implications, the cultural nature of violence, and specifically the cultural nature of domestic violence in this case. And I'll keep it short. There's a few avenues that we're going to take. One of them is cultural prerogatives. You know, so that's just to say that the violence that manifests is shaped by whatever those cultures are oriented towards. And, you know, like Julia mentioned with the Palestine example, right? Israel and Palestine. Palestine is an oppressed state, constantly at war. So the men who are perpetuating domestic violence aren't doing it in a vacuum where they're just, you know, angry men who go to work and then come home and then, you know, perpetuate violence, you know, against their wives, right? They're oftentimes men who are actively engaged in acts of very real physical violence against the oppressive state. And when you, I mean, a parallel here domestically is, again, as Julia brought up, is the idea of police work, police officers, particularly male police officers who go to work, and, you know, it's not like they go to work, a lot of them, and sit at a desk and then do nothing, or sit at a desk and do desk work, you know, white collar work. They go to work, they carry guns, they're armed, they're taught to be violent in order to engage in that profession, right? There's a violence, a pervasive culture of violence and preparedness to perpetuate violence and essentially be abusive in the culture of American police and arguably police internationally. Israeli police, there's a lot of contact there as far as training is concerned. So you exist in this culture so many hours out of the day, and then you come home, and, you know, one of the things that Julia and I were talking about, Julia noted that you can't just come home and turn this off. You can't say, oh, okay, now I'm oriented towards peace and pacifism, and then tomorrow I'm going to wake up and go back to work and orient towards abuse and oppression. So the prerogative of police culture, in order to be a police officer, you need to subscribe in some way to this culture of violence and oppression. And one of the prices for subscribing to that culture is, in fact, not being able to turn it off and then coming home and subscribing your family to it. So that's one of the things.
I do think, like, one thing that feels a little bit different, perhaps, and this isn't something I've, that we've really talked about yet, but in terms of, like, police and wanting to be a police officer, and what we talked about, like, what I shared at the beginning about power and control, right? Like, that idea is a little bit different than fighting for your freedom and your liberation. Right. However, like, the culture of violence and your everyday being consumed by violence in some sort would make it much more difficult to come home and then think about ways to have, like, healthy conflict resolution, perhaps.
Right.
Which doesn't mean that it's not a choice. It just means that your understanding of power and control and how to gain that has been so shifted by the violent culture.
Right. So there's this important question. Yeah. The important factor of power and control is still at the core. On the one hand, you go out and you're a police officer and, right, you want to exert your power and control on the people who you are protecting and serving. I'm going to use finger quotes because I think that's fair. That's how you're exercising your power and control versus exercising your power and control to fight against the state. Even though, like, the core motivations are different, the vehicle that you're using to exercise those core motivations are similar enough that the effect, the impact on the people you love is the same. Because ultimately what you're doing is you're orienting towards violence in order to exercise your power and control in a certain direction. And that orientation towards violence manifests not just in one direction, but like Julia said, you know, you look at the wheel and you extrapolate that not just as far as a single interpersonal relationship, but towards all of your relationships and how you interact, it radiates. This cultural element is in the idea of normalization and perpetuation of domestic violence across a certain number of different avenues. Again, starting with media narratives, and in particular, movies, the news, television. What the media portrays is consistent with more generally acceptable notions of masculinity, right? Which itself is problematic. You add all these together, and what people see is that if I feel a certain way emotionally, even though this isn't the way, even though abuse isn't the way to... it's not the best way to exercise what I feel, it is a way to exercise what I feel. And it's acceptable enough that the media harps on it, right? That the media constantly reinforces that message.
Mm-hmm. And another danger of that, too, is that that doesn't include all of the abusers who are calculated and manipulative in their behaviors, right? Like, an emotional outburst while still abuse is like kind of like what you're saying, like people, right, like people can empathize with that in a way, as opposed to this like kind of more like distant, cold, calculating type of abuse that a lot of people experience.
Right. Another avenue through which culture perpetuates, or really through which society perpetuates violence in this way, against, you know, women, against children, domestic violence, is through jokes and through humor. And just right off the bat, you know, you call people out on the jokes they tell, they talk about political correctness, they say this and that, all you trying to like get rid of all humor. And, you know, my point is not, right, okay, so there's two points. One, humor is not under attack, right? By calling out a joke, I am not attacking humor. The humor is a fundamental aspect of human society that is not predicated on, you know, making light of abuse. If you can't be funny without being conscious of the abuse that you're perpetuating, then
you're not very funny.
Yeah, then you're not very funny. And there's, right, rape jokes. These are categories. There are categories of jokes, right, that we identify, like rape jokes, black jokes, racist jokes, Jewish jokes. Right. And none of these things perpetuate nice ideas. You know, the nature of racist jokes or sexist jokes or any jokes aimed at a group of people seem more in some way deviant from the norm is that they are attacks on those people designed to perpetuate and reinforce often harmful and inaccurate stereotypes about a group of people who don't need your help having lies and half-truths spread about them. And the example I'll give here is the other day I went to work, right? I was at work. This was, you know, only a few weeks ago. And comes in. I'm not going to name him. But he comes in and he's with his kids. And, right, like I was the last person to come in before he did. And he likes to leave the door locked. So I left the door unlocked. And he comes in and opens the door. And he's like, oh, you know, he just says in passing, like someone, you know, like they left the door unlocked. They must have been hoping to get raped. And he just said it like that, like in passing. And he has like a 2-year-old daughter and like a 4-year-old son. And they're with him. And I was just like, you know, I can't really describe the feeling, but it felt like a cortisol flush. I was like, did I actually hear that correctly? And that's a perfect example, I think, right? It took me a while to like formulate my thoughts around that and feelings, but it's a perfect example of how people make light of these things in a way, right? Because it normalizes the idea of hoping to be raped for these kids, right? Like they're assuming that was the first time they'd heard such a joke like that, and assuming it sticks to some degree, and further assuming that they're going to hear more of that stuff, right? Because like he's not the only person who's ever going to make a joke. I mean, hopefully he is, but likely, in all likelihood, he's not the only person who's going to make a joke like that in their lives. They're going to be exposed more and more to it. And what that does is ultimately, one, normalizes the idea of rape, right? Two, you know, perpetuates this false narrative of like that people can hope to be raped, that like people can behave in such a way as to invite rape upon them.
And excuse behavior if you do rape somebody whose door is open.
Right.
Right? It doesn't just normalize rape for the perpetrator. It normalizes rape for the survivor as well.
Right.
Which is also incredibly damaging.
And these are things to keep in mind, right? Especially, again, when you multiply them beyond the individual instance, right? Because that's often another thing that people say, oh, it was just a joke, right? But just one joke multiplied over the span of a lifetime, right, of telling one joke over and over again, further multiplied by everyone in your society agreeing that it's just a joke and therefore perpetuating that same one joke over the course of lifetimes, it impacts the way people see the world, right? It impacts what is seen as normal.
Also, it's just not funny, right? Like, committing violence against another individual is not funny. Killing people, not funny. Raping somebody, not funny.
I think, ideally, it's not funny. But the fact of the matter is, in this society, right? Like, you look at, and this goes back to what I was saying about the history of, right, cultural prerogatives and how that history informs society. This society was one built on genocide and slavery and things, right? And in order to perpetuate those atrocities, they had to be normalized. And thus, right, whether it's at home, whether it's at church, whether it's at work, all of these things were normalized, and humor manifests in what is normal and, you know, what is absurd. But like popular humor manifests in what is normal. So to an extent, these things being normal are made funny, right? They're allowed to be funny because they're normal. That doesn't mean that they should be funny. And it does bear reflecting on what you and your values are if you do see these things as humorous, right? Because I can't tell you what isn't funny and what to find funny, what not to find funny. But I can tell you, we can both tell you, that if you do find certain things funny, there's probably some significant disconnect between your professed values and your actual values. So, you know, that's worth keeping in mind. And then the last thing that I'll get into, right, is how culture itself perpetuates these things. And the example that I'll give here as far as perpetuating domestic violence is the idea of corporal punishment. And, you know, like spanking your kids, right? For a lot of parents, you know, that's just the status quo. And they'll be like, oh yeah, my parents did that to me. My uncle did that to their kids. You know, like my grandparents did that to their, like the whole family does it, right? That's just the way you do it. It's the MO for correcting bad behavior. And I think, unfortunately, what happens is that these things become culture through certain historical means that we don't often understand as they manifest in the present. And then we perpetuate that culture without ever questioning how it came about or what the actual repercussions of that behavior are and whether they're even effective. And I think corporal punishment is a really good example of that because, right, corporal punishment in the African-American community is, I mean, you don't hear about it so much now, but like 20 years ago, 15 years ago, and before, right, people were up in arms, you know, as far as, I mean, white people were like, oh man, like, you know, black people are beating up their kids, you know, and black people are like, oh man, you know, like this is...
white parents aren't doing it.
Right, right, by like larger numbers, you know? And then, you know, it's absurd because, that much more absurd because you trace the historical lineage, right? Again, it's not, corporal punishment is not something that's necessarily endemic to the human condition. People aren't born knowing that the best way to discipline their children is to hit them or to beat them up. That's learned behavior. And culturally, it was a learned behavior it's a vestige of the slavery era, right? It's a vestige of European vassalage, right? Indentured servitude. How do you maintain power, right? It's a, I mean, long story short, history of the world, it's the way that masters treat their slaves, right? So, you know, as African Americans, that's a behavior that we learned in that context, and then we perpetuate it, you know, to our children. We perpetuate it, unfortunately, in that way without ever really questioning it, right? And, you know, in the context of slavery, what does that really teach you? In the context of child rearing, what does that teach the person who's being whipped, right? Sometimes it'll deter certain behaviors, but, you know, more likely than not, what it's going to teach you is to be more discreet in, you know, engaging in bad behaviors, mm-hmm. right? It's going to teach you not to get caught doing bad things. And, you know, according to, like, good psychology, it's not even the most effective way of disciplining children or of eliciting the behaviors you want and quenching mm-hmm. the behaviors that you don't want. So as far as efficacy, that argument doesn't even, it shouldn't resonate, right? That's another thing. People will be like, oh, well, I do it because it works, or, you know, like, you know, it worked for me, you know, so it should work for everybody. It's not, that's not the way psychology works. That's not the way punishment works versus rewarding certain behaviors.
I just want to say that you can be a cycle breaker, right? So like if you're willing to do the work and engage in the process of reflection and understanding your own values and what worked for you and what hasn't worked for you, you can break the cycle in your families.
Very true. So make it happen. Just like you're holding your, and a lot of times what that looks like is just like, you know, we called for holding your friends accountable to their abusive behaviors, especially not just as far as breaking the cycle in what you're doing, but helping to break the cycle in what you see happening around you. If you see that your parents are like, you know, abusing their children, or, you know, your younger siblings, or, right, your extended family is doing the same thing, right? That's a place to step in and say, hey, that's not the way, right? And then also step in with some alternatives, because those cycles are more likely to be broken when alternatives are presented versus just saying, hey, stop doing that behavior. I do want to point out the relationship between corporal punishment and domestic violence and police work is really interesting, because, right, it's one of those things, you know, specifically in the African-American community, or as far as what I'm focusing on, it's not an issue that affects the African-American community exclusively, but that's what we're focusing on here. Is there was this big call for, obviously, like every so many years, calling out police brutality, excessive use of force, all of these things, right? You're calling out the agents of this institution that centers violence as a means of manifesting their control and power. Meanwhile, advocating, on the other hand, for corporal punishment, right? And what's another thing that teaches children is that physical abuse is a viable tool to punish bad behaviors. And it's, it teaches them to respect, to a certain extent, or fear respectfully, the person who's doing that behavior, which it correlates directly to your relationship with the police, right? So on the one hand, and this is something Julie and I talk about actually quite a bit, especially in this context. On the one hand, you're calling for an end to, like, the police to stop beating people up. And on the other hand, we're still beating up our children. And those children are being raised, right, to believe that it's okay in some way to beat people up, right? If you want justice, violence, physical violence is a viable means of getting there. And it's just, it's not. That should not be the modus operandi. It should not be the default. And that gets into child abuse. According to the World Health Organization, over 1 million children in the past year have suffered from some form of mental, emotional, physical abuse, right? 2.2 million children exist in the world. So that's just about half of all children have experienced some sort of abuse in that sense. And that's whatever the reported figures are. And as Julia mentioned, you know, a lot of times, and children are included in this, right? To whatever extent that women don't feel safe reporting, right? So a lot of these statistics are underreported. The same thing manifests for children, right? Whether it's due to a need to protect their family, feeling to protect their family, or to protect themselves, or to protect the abuser, there's a lot of underreporting going on. I can't verify the statistic, but it's that 85% of children who are abused grow up to either, or are, okay, rather, yeah, the statistic is 85% of children who are exposed to child abuse situations grow up to either be abusers or to be abused. And I think a more well-rounded way of saying that is to say that the chances go up. If you're abused as a child, then the chances of you becoming an abuser or becoming abused as an adult go up. And that's a testament to the idea that domestic violence behavior is learned behavior. So if you are exposed to it as a child, if you are the victim of it, then you are that much more likely to learn, whether it's through that direct contact, whether it's through media, whether it's through the culture, whether it's through a confluence of all of those things, you're more likely to learn that either me being an abuser is the best way to get to a certain result, right? It's the best way to operate. Or that me being abused is also just part of the natural order of things, right? It's meant to happen, right? It happened when I was a kid. It's happening now. And this goes into what Julia said, that much more importantly, about breaking the cycle, right? Because a lot of this stuff does perpetuate through culture.
So we want to talk a little bit about solutions that some organizations have proposed and some things that are happening right now, but that just may not be happening on a large enough scale. And so the first thing is money. So there's just not enough money, which isn't really surprising since, like, given the statistics, right, that we just talked about and shared and how culture in various countries perpetuates and condones and in some cases endorses violence against women, or at the very least, like, doesn't punish it or, speak out against it. It's not surprising that there wouldn't be enough money or enough resources. So, and one of those things that I really think that there is a significant lack of understanding about what it takes for an individual who has experienced trauma and abuse to heal. And I often go on this pitch with Kojo, which is that if psychologists were listened to more often than perhaps economists or lawyers, then our legislation would look quite different, because there would be a really, or I guess I should say, like, if certain psychologists, yeah, if therapists, really, like, yeah. If certain therapists were listened to a lot more, because, you know, like, the APA did not do its thing with the torture business, yeah. as in they did their thing with the torture business. So,
that should be another podcast.
Yeah. So, it just feels like there's this general lack of understanding and lack of care, really, that a lot of governments have about this issue that affects so many people, right? Because it doesn't just affect the victims and survivors, it's also affecting the perpetrators. And so when we think about that, I mean, it's really like most people in the world who could benefit from some sort of resource. So money is really important in terms of immediate care and longer term care, and providing care for men to provide empathy training. We'll talk a little bit more about that in just one moment. And then, you know, things like paid sick leave, paid child care, paying women for the unpaid care work that they do to create some financial stability, and resources for them could be really beneficial. Several European countries have adopted right now, in the midst of the pandemic, this code phrase, which is called Mask 19, and they can go in and going to a pharmacy, which is one of the few places they're able to go when they're on lockdown, and to request a mask 19, and the pharmacy workers then know who they need to contact and that individual is in danger. And some other, you know, places have done that. Like there are some bars and some restaurants that like post signs about sex trafficking, and also will say, you know, like, go order this from the bartender if you need help and you're in a difficult situation or in a dangerous date or something like that. So things like that are great. However, it leaves a lot of room for human error too. And it also requires eventually more money to be poured into those additional resources, right? So like if women are going in and are asking for mask 19, but the shelter is full, like then what happens? And so money. Funding empathy training for men and emotional wellness for men and healthy relationship training is so important. And Kojo and I often talk about like the poverty of imagination and how we are as a society trained to think inside of structures and how we can shift and adapt inside those structures to create change. Well, what we need is to dismantle some structures and to use our imagination and think about providing empathy training for boys and men from a young age, right? Like we have reading and writing and science and math and art classes and music classes. And empathy training is so, so, so important in training people around mental wellness and mental health and well-being and relationships, because that can ultimately is going to have the greatest effect and can help people be advocates for others. So it feels like a complex project, but it's certainly not one that's outside the realm of imagination or possibility. And it's great. Like, I know that some people do this now in their classrooms or in schools, but shifting the educational system in that sense just feels so important and so doable and so much more useful than some other things that are happening in schools for sure. If you want to see a great example of empathy training in action, you can check out the film The Mask We Live In. It's a great film. I don't know where it's available, but you can check it out.
It might be available on Netflix.
Yeah. Not that I want to endorse Netflix, but here we are. So one of the other things we will put in our description, well, a way that you can directly help too is, you know, you can donate money if you have some money available right now. There are plenty of resources. You can donate to the National Domestic Violence Hotline in the United States if you want to. You can research your own organizations to donate to as well. You can just type in country name or state or city domestic violence hotline and go that route. They're all there. You can also be a source of support for somebody. I mean, there are ways to share on social media that you are that you're willing and able to listen, support, and provide some sort of resources if you have them. And that can vary greatly. So we're also going to put in our descriptions some of the domestic violence hotlines from various countries that we have found. So you can check those out as well. So that wraps up our topics for today. I do want to address a question that one of our listeners asked in either like the last pod or the one before that, which was tips on getting involved. And so there are tons of ways to get involved, but we also know that it can feel really overwhelming, especially when things for some people right now already feel quite overwhelming. So my best advice around that is to find a cause that you're really passionate in and interested in, because to do the work, you'll need to be passionate because that's got to keep you going. And then you can either search for like government organizations in your state or city that are doing those things. You can do web searches for mutual aid organizations that are doing those things, or grassroots organizations. So for instance, if you're out interested in houselessness, you can Google houselessness San Diego, or houseless organizations or homeless organizations, you know, whatever language it is that your area is using. You can go that route. Social media is often an organizing tool, so you can also search for organizations on social media. You can also, you know, in your day-to-day life, if you are in contact with folks who are already doing some of that work, connect with them, just reach out. They're always, you know, open to more support, or at least that's what we found. If you encounter people in your daily life who are in need of food or shelter, you can stop and ask them what it is that they need and if you can provide that for them. And that's a way to help too.
And I have a bit more of an abstract approach. I mean, obviously everything that Julia said, I totally agree with. That's how we engage. But one of the avenues that I will suggest is that you, around an issue, figure out what issue that you really want to solve, right? Write it down and then map out a solution to that issue, okay? Like, this is something I did at the beginning of the year. I was like, oh, okay, I'm going to solve homelessness and, or, you know, houselessness. So I made a plan for how to do that. And what I think the value in that is in, ideally, right, in working towards that plan, especially for as big an issue as that, you're going to come across organizations that you can work with, right? Organizations that you can volunteer with, work with to gain the experience and knowledge of like what people are doing to solve that issue. And also you have your own thing, right? Because sometimes working with these organizations does get exhausting. You get burned out. You feel like you're hitting dead ends and you're never going to solve something. So just having this idea that you want to solve and this roadmap to solve that kind of helps avoid that burnout, right? Like you say, okay, this is what I'm working towards and they're also working towards this. It's going to work out. Or at the very least, if I'm not going to do work with this organization, I can come back to this and work on solving this issue on my own. But what that does is it puts you in the place of someone who's actually invested in solving that problem, which I think is a major, right? Like we talked about a couple of podcasts ago, it's easy to lose that investment if you're working towards something that's too disconnected, right? You're like, oh, okay, I'm kind of interested in this thing, so I'm going to work with this organization, versus saying, this is what I'm interested in, this is what I want to solve, so I'm going to work with these organizations and figure out how I can solve that, right? You're more likely to find something that you're going to be invested in if you take the time to really sit down beforehand and figure out what it is that you're going to be invested in. But don't take too much time. Yeah.
Yeah. I think we're both good examples of that in some different ways in terms of, you know, Kojo wanted to solve houselessness. And I was like, yeah, I'm about it. Like, let's go figure this out. So we went and joined an organization. And then eventually I realized that I like cooking for houseless people and feeding people. And that's where my passions are. And Kojo's, you know, still going with his passion. So we all find it in different ways. And we have many passions. And that's the other thing. You won't solve every single problem. You certainly won't solve them all on your own. And it's okay to pick one. You don't have to feel like you need to spread yourself thin and do 5 or 6 different things. Depending on the organization and their needs, being able to commit a few hours a week to one organization is going to ultimately be more effective than doing 1 hour for a few organizations a week. So you just got to kind of figure that out on your own and what you have the capacity for.
Yeah. And then I have one final thing. And this is the thing that I've really recently put a name to. I'm going to call it right now, politicize your life, right? That's another road to doing, right? If you're an artist, if you work professionally, whatever you do in your free time, whatever you enjoy doing, and of course, this isn't something you have to do, but if you can, if you want to engage, make that engagement a part of everything you do, then politicize your life, right? If you paint and you normally just paint landscapes, figure out where you fall in the political spectrum, what you believe in, and paint landscapes that reflect what you believe, right? Paint landscapes that are littered with trash, or paint landscapes that show people picking up trash, right? Paint what the world could look like if we go down this road or not, right? You know, what I've started doing is making capoeira, and I guess I've been doing this for a while, but capoeira videos to certain audio tracks of people talking about real things, right? Because people don't necessarily want to sit down and listen to a whole speech, right? But they might watch someone do capoeira, and in the meantime, the audio is going, oh, you know, like, vote blue no matter who is for schmucks, you know, for a few minutes. And then you're like, oh, yeah, like, while I was listening to this, watching this cool thing, like, this message rang. So politicize your life. Make engagement, make political engagement, social activist engagement part of what you do in whatever way you can, right? You don't necessarily have to leave the house and, you know, contact other organizations. If everyone did a little bit to incorporate, right, like what Julia just said, she loves to cook, so she's still doing what she loves to do in the context of something that's helping people, okay? Versus doing what she loves to do for herself, which is fine, but if you do want to engage, right, it's not that big of a step to take it that much further by politicizing what you love to do.
Mm-hmm. That's it. And conversations, right? I mean, you can always politicize your life and what you love to do if you love to connect with other people and have conversations. And that doesn't mean you need to have arguments, but right, being curious, inquiring, talking about politics as opposed to being like, it's not one of the things we talk about.
Yeah.
You can have those conversations too.
Politics.
And one last thing, shout out to my sister cousin, Victoria, for my Don't Tell Me to Smile t-shirt.
And also shout out to Moran holding it down in New York. If you're watching for this from New York, y'all don't know, but you owe this man an incredible debt because he's holding it down. Without him, y'all would just be in that much more trouble. Believe it. Believe it.
Thanks, Moran.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks. Thanks, bro. All right. If y'all want shout-outs, let us know that you've been watching these videos. That's how we'll know that you made it to the end of this video.
Or send us really cool t-shirts.
Or send us...
Thanks for watching, y'all.
Thanks for watching. See you next time.
Yeah. And subscribe, comment, ask us questions, make comments.
Boom.
All right.
Bye. Bye. Meow.